Hey guys, it's Six Gun back with another informational video. Thanks for following, and I know I haven't been posting a lot of videos of late. There's a lot of stuff that we've been putting on the live stream, but a lot of it has not been interesting enough for YouTube, frankly. But if you want to watch a lot of the other stuff, it's on my Twitch channel. A lot of those live streams are there full length unedited, so if you have some time to kill and you want people to watch, you need to watch people fly helicopters for hours on end, there you go. That's the place to go. But today I wanted to talk about the Task Force Arrowhead radio mod for Arma 3 and how best to use it for aviation, right? And specifically rotary aviation. That's what I do primarily, but it also applies to fixed wing. These principles also apply to vehicle, or if you are a JTAC or long-range radioman on the ground and need to manage multiple frequencies, there's some really good procedures and some knowledge that will help you become more effective. And generally some information about the mod itself that will let MILSIM units and playing groups use the radio mod a little more effectively. So the TFAR is one of the two big radio mods for Arma, the other being ACRE, and I think ACRE precedes TFAR. I've used ACRE a little bit. I'm not a fan of it. That's probably because I'm not accustomed to using it. And I'm not sure which is more realistic in terms of some of the features each one has. I do like the fact that ACRE in an aircraft will have multiple radio stacks and both flight crew are actually operating the same radios. That's kind of cool, because in TFAR, each person has their own aircraft radio or vehicle radio that they can program independently. Now, that can either be an advantage or disadvantage depending on how you want to set up and how you operate with your gaming group, right? But mostly I'm going to be talking about how we do it and how I like to do it, how I have learned how to operate TFAR and be very effective and maintain a fairly high degree of situational awareness even while comms are really going crazy. And I'm going to do a lot of editing in this video. I'm going to edit in some moments where comms get a little confused and some of the things that I'm listening for. First off, let me talk about what TFAR is. Obviously, the designer put in a whole suite of radio transceivers for blue 4, red 4, green 4, and they're all encrypted to be only effective for that side. Now, mostly it doesn't get used for pure multiplayer. It's used for fighting against AI, so everyone mostly has experience with using the blue 4 radios. So the most common personal radio is going to be the PRIC 152, which I have right here. This is based on the actual real Harris radio, PRC-152 embedder. Embedder meaning multi-band intra-team radio. And this is the same radio set that you're going to see used by military people around the world, and it's going to be encrypted with their particular encryption algorithm and probably pre-programmed with a bunch of frequencies you can access with channels, right? And that's basically how this works. So you see it open up with channel 1. Channel 1 is dialed into a certain frequency. You can double click and edit that frequency and change the frequency and save it. Or you can go from channel to channel to channel, and they're either pre-programmed but at random, or you can set up a mission where you have a bunch of radio frequencies pre-programmed at the beginning of the mission so that everyone just has to worry about what channel they're going to be broadcasting on. This also has volume control, and I'm not connected to TeamSpeak, so you're not going to be seeing the normal cues in the lower right side of the screen. It's got volume control. This is the whip antenna, and I think this is the jack that connects to a bigger antenna. And then some of these functions are not the same as on the real radio, but this clears the scratch pad, this enters the scratch pad, this is a way of going between channels, and then this turns the speakers on. You can set an additional channel, I'll be talking about that function shortly, and then set the stereo settings where you can decide, is it going to be heard up the center or in the right or in the left. And you have to really glance in the right lower corner of the screen to really see what I'm doing right now. I'm going to be setting this to left and right, so it's going to be heard right in the middle of my head, essentially. Now, the way this mod is set up, and everyone pretty much goes along with the way the mod maker, the terminology the mod maker uses. He uses the terminology of short-range frequencies and long-range frequencies. And these radios are programmed with a specific bandwidth of frequencies. In reality, there's no such thing as a short-range or long-range frequency. There's only short-range or long-range transmitters or antenna. Right, so this Harris 152 probably has a 5-watt transmitter. I don't really know for sure, but it's probably 5-watt given the fact that its range is about 5 kilometers. It probably has better reach if you put a longer, like a quarter-wave antenna on it. If you put a longer antenna, think of an antenna as being like a speaker in a PA system. That's the part that emits the energy and also pulls in the signal. The fact is, all of the radio sets can talk to each other on a variety of frequencies. So, in TFAR, the four Blue 4 radios are these. The personal radios, you have either the RF7800S-TR, which is basically a squad radio, has a range of 30 to 512 megahertz, has a range of about 2 kilometers. So that'd be like a fire team radio. The one I've got up here is the PRC152. Has the same thing, a range of 30 to 512 megahertz, and it's got a 5 kilometer range. Then the vehicle radio, or the aircraft radio, is the ARC210. Let me hop in the radio and open it up. And here it is. This is the ARC210. And if you look at a picture of a real ARC210, it looks just like this. This has a frequency range of 30 to 87 megahertz and has a range of 40 kilometers. That's a transmission or reception range of 40 kilometers. The other one that I don't have here is the backpack radio. And the most common Blue 4 backpack radio is the RT1523 Golf. It's the same frequency range as this guy. So all the long-range radios in TFAR have a range of 30 to 87 megahertz. However, the backpack radio's transmit range is about 20 kilometers, so it's about half of the aircraft built-in aircraft radio. Now, in TFAR, both the right seater and the left seater have their own ARC210, and they can program them independently of each other. Now, I don't know how realistic that is, given whatever aircraft you're in. Most military aircraft, in fact, most civil aircraft, have at least two communications radios. If for no other reason, so if you're flying through controlled airspace, you can very quickly switch from one frequency to the next because you've got that freak already dialed up in the other radio and you just hit the button to switch to that radio as the active. In addition to navigation radios, but ARMA doesn't simulate navigation radios. Anyway, here's the thing. In the frequency range of 30 to 87 megahertz, all of the Blue 4 radios can talk to each other. So your ARC210 can talk to your PRIC 512 if you maintain everybody in this frequency range. Bear in mind, anywhere from 30 to 87 includes up to 3 decimal places. 30.123. Let's see. Maybe it only allows 2 decimal places. Or maybe I don't know how to type. Maybe that's what's going on. Yeah, 30.30. I'm not going to use the period on the keypad. I don't want to take a Steam screenshot. 0.123. Okay, so it only allows 1 decimal place. No, it only allows 1 decimal place. But at least what that means is between 30 and 87, you have 10 decimal places inside each frequency band, you can assign for different functions. Okay? Now, this part is not realistic because 35 to 87 megahertz is not reserved for military radio use. It's reserved for a whole bunch of other stuff. I happen to know, I'm a ham radio operator, I happen to know that the 50 to 60 megahertz range is a ham band. It's called the 6-meter band. 30 up to, like 27 is CB radio, and 28 to 29 is like 11-meter ham. So, and these are low quality, these are bigger bandwidth or wavelength frequencies. So it doesn't really matter because we're not matching the real UHF or VHF frequencies that are used by the military. We don't have to. They're just random numbers, number values that you can enter in, right? But what you want to do is use radio frequencies that everybody can talk on. And the only difference is the power of the transmitter or the antenna. So a guy carrying a 152 can hear an aircraft that may be 20 or 30 miles away. He's not necessarily able to respond if the aircraft can't hear. Also, and we all know this, if we've used these mods for any length of time, even though these radios have this rated transmission range, that's affected by line of sight, that's affected by terrain. We've all had that happen, and I can point to any one of a number of videos on my channel of hearing people go out of range because they're out of range, they're behind terrain, primarily is what it is. The map we're operating on now is the port from the Takon Helicopters South Asia map. It's vast, it's enormous. We did a mission Wednesday night where we literally transited two Black Hawks and two Chinooks to set up a FARP to support operations. And it was about 80 miles as the crow flies, but of course we had to take a circuitous route around terrain because we had to avoid surface-to-air threats. I was literally flying a Black Hawk for an hour straight. 1 hour of just flying. If you want to see it on YouTube, I'll post it, but maybe I'll just put a link to the Twitch video and you can sit, and if you need to go to sleep, there's nothing quicker to put you to sleep than just hear a Black Hawk engine running for an hour with nobody talking, right? So in a terrain like that, you have to, I mean, obviously we had to start thinking about fuel. That's why we set up a FARP, but you also have to start thinking about the range of your comms. Because if you're out of range of the 152, that can happen even if you're flying in formation and you can see the other aircraft, but you're out of 152 range. That's when you want to rely on either a backpack radio or the aircraft radio, and here's the aircraft radio. Now, let me talk about the alternate frequency setup, and this is what I do when I program my radios. I have my, it's on screen, my throttle. There it is right there. You see me moving that switch. This is a Warthog throttle. I have all my comms mapped to this control, this thumb switch. Control up is for TeamSpeak. I have forward for long-range transmit. Rear for long-range alternate channel transmit, and down for short-range transmit. That way I can monitor and talk on three different frequencies, although I'm aware that the short-range radio is very limited. Typically the pilots in our unit will use the short-range radios when we're at the base and we need to find out where each other is, or we need to find out where the aircraft is, or notify each other of what's going on. And then my habit is, as soon as I get in the aircraft, the first thing I do is I set up my radios. That's the very first thing. In my mind, if your radios are not set up, that is a no-go. In my mind, you cannot take off if your radios are not set up. That's a flight hazard, because if you can't communicate, you know, all of a sudden, what's that guy doing? What's he doing over there? What's going on, right? So here's what I do. So I'll have channel 1 set up for whatever frequency. Let's say it's 62.9, which is fine. Now 62.9, I'm going to transmit with a forward switch. In my mind, that's going to the right. Right? So that means I'm going to put this guy in my right ear. And you just saw that. Left and right. Left, right. So when I hear anyone in my right ear, I know I press to the right to talk to them. Then I'm going to go to channel 2, and it can be whatever other frequency. I'm going to set this up as the additional channel. I'm going to set my additional channel as to come in my left ear. Left and right, left only. And the trick is now I got to go back to my primary channel. I'm already monitoring channel 2. If I key the mic to the right, I'm hearing things to my right. If I key the mic to the left, I'm hearing stuff on my left. So my ears are telling me what frequency, even without anyone telling me what frequency they're transmitting on, by what ear I hear it in, I already know. And then my short range, I leave it on both left and right. So if I'm hearing radio traffic in the center of my head, I know that short range. Now what we do typically in our unit is we set up 6.5 as our primary aviation frequency, just because that's what we do. And we set up 49.6 as our sort of air-to-ground slash JTAC slash utility infielder slash, you know, whatever you need to do kind of frequency. So that those are the two that we are responsible for as aviators. There's a third frequency that gets used sometimes, and I will monitor that sometimes, and that's 77.7. We just call it 777 for short. And this is the mission admin frequency. This is when the unit commander is talking to the mission creator, and we're setting up. We're going to be setting up cues for, you know, starting triggering the AI to do something or anything like that. I have that, and I have the volume turned down because I'm not going to be transmitting on this. Turn it down a little bit, but I do want to hear what's going on. Now with these three, I've got really good SA, situational awareness, on what's going on. Now, how do you set up the Warthog throttle for TFAR? Here's the problem. ARMA does not see most of the Warthog throttle commands. Most of these switches are not visible. For example, if I configure add-on options and I go to TFAR, actually, no, it's not here. Where am I going? I'm going to controls, add-ons. If I had my druthers, I would simply have, where's the transmit? Yeah, long-range transmit additional. I'd have these mapped directly to my TFAR controls. But this particular hat switch is not visible to the game. Now, what could I do? I could set it up as a custom command, but all my custom commands are used up for other functions, and a lot of that I've got used up for a lot of the switches on this throttle. My engine start switch, gear up, gear down is mapped to a switch, and that's a custom command. The hatchet mod H60, when you push a button or flip a switch, those are all set to custom commands. So all my custom commands are used up. So what I use is a free app that I found called Joy2Key, and it sees any joystick and remaps it as a keyboard input. So by default, short range transmit is caps lock, long range transmit is control caps lock, long range transmit additional is T. And I have those set, and I'm going to inset that image right here. I have those set on Joy2Key. I have to have Joy2Key running before I start ARMA. And then I'm able to function no problem with the radios. There you go. And if you listen, you'll hear left ear, right ear, and I'll know just by hearing them what frequency they're on. And our habit is we try to limit aviation conversations, flight safety stuff, airfield, flight safety separation. We limit that to the aviation frequency so as not to clog up the air-to-ground frequency with stuff that's not pertinent. In fact, a lot of the air-to-ground frequency is used for, you know, gun calls, LZ pickups, CASAVACs, and that's where a lot of information has to get passed back and forth, so you definitely don't want to clog that up with irrelevant you know, not mission essential or relevant information. So that's it. That's just my overview of how to run TFAR in a way that's efficient. This is just from a point of view of aviators. However, if you're a ground guy that has to run the backpack radio and you need to be able to manage all these frequencies plus manage your squad frequency on your short range, you can set that up off the keyboard. And the secret weapon is putting each frequency in a different ear. So while everything's going crazy, you have a little higher degree of situational awareness and hopefully can respond effectively to the right agency with the right answer to the right question, right? Because we all have had that moment in a mission where everybody is going nuts on the radio and you need to hear all of it and you're not sure which is more important. It's always like that. What can you do? You do your best. But that's part of the fun of the game. That's why we enjoy it. Hopefully this was useful to you guys. I know it's been useful to me, and it enhances my gameplay. And again, I'll be putting out more videos soon. We're ramping up operations with the Phoenix group. And some of the things that we've been doing so far, as I said, have been a little monotonous. So I haven't really added that stuff to YouTube. But that will be hopefully changing soon. And I appreciate your support for the channel. Till the next time, we'll talk to you later. Fly safe.